it's the 17th of February 2024, and here I am with Marie, and we're going to talk a little bit about our exhibition here at Common Ground here in Featherston. My name's Steve Austin, and I'm really pleased to be with you today, Marie. Your work is very interesting to me, and I'm really hoping that through a little bit of discussion that I'll learn a little bit more about you and your work, and that we'll have a great resource to look back on and see how things are going to evolve or have evolved.
Thank you.
Marie, you were saying earlier that you were born in England, and so I just wondered if it would be good just if you could tell us a little bit about where you're from, growing up, a little bit about your life to start off with.
Sure. So, from a little town called Hinckley, which is in the Midlands in the UK, old industrial town, so a lot of industry there back in the day, mid-1900s, and that all trickled away, and quite a dynamic, interesting place to live, quite rough around the edges, and quite a character-building place to be, I think, as well. I'm the middle child of two brothers. Mum and dad brought us up in Hinckley.
So the 80s and 90s, that like economically, that would have been quite a challenging environment for the local economy.
It feels like Hinckley's in decline, and it has been in decline for a long time. There's not much happening there. It's kind of a bit of a middle ground that people use to get to cities and places nearby. But it has got some real interesting historic aspects to it as well. I think the church dates back to kind of the 1060, I think, really old kind of part of the Domesday Book. Loads of interesting rich history, but just an interesting environment around it. And don't want to be derogatory about
that. No, it is what it is.
But it certainly is an interesting place. It's interesting when I go back. I went back recently and I was kind of walking around a bit in awe, taking lots of photographs, feeling quite inspired by the aesthetic of it, the character of it, and reflecting a lot on that's part of the place that built me and influences me. Maybe sometimes quite subtly, but
And what sort of kid were you?
I think quite sociable, quite out there, quite loud. Had a big brother that was very misbehaved and naughty, and a little brother who was very shy and sweet. And I think I was just in between of them two things.
And your parents, were they interested in the visual arts, or just sort of more of an average sort of family, would you say?
Yeah, I wouldn't say particularly interested in art. I wouldn't say they disliked art, but not that much happening in the family home in terms of art. If we went on holiday, they would often make it their business to go and buy a nice print of a place that we'd been to, which is that's a tradition that I've kind of carried on, actually, weirdly. Mum worked very hard. She was a nurse. She raised three children by herself as, father kind of went out to work kind of thing. And have kind of a newfound respect and admiration for that as I've got older. I don't think you do at the time, but...
I think we take it for granted, don't we? And we think it's normal and everybody has this. And then we start to realise that actually we're doing all right. My sister and I thought we were growing up in a Nazi training camp. Looking back, it wasn't quite.
It's
horrific. A lot of kids have worse. And I think you were telling me last night that you also have a background in planning and design. That was sort of a route that you took. So you did some art at school, presumably, to kick things off?
So always focused on art where there was opportunity to do so. So did GCSE level art and then went on to A level art at college and did that for a few years. Really enjoyed that. I liked the freedom you were given. So the studio at college was very much go in when you've got the time, do it yourself. Teachers here to support and guide you, but there was a lot of freedom to it, and that was real. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. That's a lot of my background has been in art education, and it's quite an interesting thing for each learner, whether they, how much support they need and how much freedom they need. And you know, obviously you talk to it like a duck to water in a way.
Yeah, like absolutely loved it, my favourite subject by far. But I think, you know, looking back, parents that were kind of like, you can't take that further now, you've got to do something sensible that's gonna, like, that was their attitude towards
and
it.
And it comes from a place of love, doesn't it? They're like concerned for your future and they don't want you to be impoverished.
Yeah, but you know, kind of looking back, that's interesting. You know, if I had more autonomy at that age, would I have made that choice? I don't know. I think you should do what you love, because I think you'll probably be quite good at it. And I'm starting to realise that more again now.
I also think if there's something in you, whatever you do, it's going to come out. So even if it's 10 years later, 20 years later, and you've gone through all these other family experiences, it's still going to come out if you've actually got something to say, or a point of view, or a passion. Actually, it's not going to, it's going to be there.
Yeah.
So you have to embrace it eventually.
Yeah. And yeah, it's surprising how long. It feels like it's taken a long time for that to happen to me, because this is how I love spending my time now, and I can't believe that I haven't been doing this for so long.
Someone said to me the other day that the obstacle becomes the path.
Yeah.
And it's really, because I'm old, we get a bit philosophical about these things. but I think it's really interesting that some of those earlier obstacles in our lives, we think they are permanent, but actually there's something that almost points the way.
Yeah.
So it's kind of an interesting thing. So you did that at school, and then somehow you ended up in planning, town planning or something.
Yeah.
What was that? How did that happen?
I think my dad's influence, he worked in them realms, and I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do, and I had no idea. I remember having university booklet and stuff. I knew I wanted to go to university. I wanted to, not necessarily to study, I just wanted that experience of independence, and I wanted to, you know, fly the nest kind of thing.
Yeah. And so where did you end up studying?
In Sheffield.
Right.
Which is from a small industrial town to a big industrial city. And Sheffield's a really cool place, full of character as well, really diverse city, probably about an hour and a half north. Lots of music, lots of live events, met my husband there, made friends for life, a real affiliation with that place.
Yep.
We go back there every time we go to the UK. And studied town planning there, chose town planning. I think, guided by my dad, that influenced me. There was a little bit of an aspect to be creative in there, so like some design elements, and I suppose getting really interested in that as well, around like the social geography of people. So how do people move around spaces, and why do they move like that, and what makes them do that? How does a space mould what people do? And that's my favourite part of planning.
And then would you say there's an element of how to represent that almost visually and graphically? Because there's the word side of, but then there's also the plan, you know, the actual visual representation of some of that, is there?
It is, and you get more freedom in some projects than others. Like some of it's quite regimented, this is how you present things, this is how you make maps, and I did like visual mapping for quite a while, but there's lots of standards, so it's all quite textbook.
Lots of template.
Cookie cutter type stuff. But then within that, you do have a bit of a license sometimes. I suppose it's almost mentally painting the picture rather than physically doing it. Like, how do you view that space that's going to kind of emerge, and what's it going to look like when people are using it as you've envisioned? And sometimes you get to create that picture as well. Interesting. Yeah.
We have a wonderful architect who was in New Zealand for a little while called Ernest Plischka, and he did some town plans for, I think, Nainai or something like that. He wasn't successful in winning the competitions, but it's, they're a very interesting document of how people were thinking at the time and what might have been.
Yeah, and it's interesting that just a handful of people get to decide that, really, you know, like, yeah, we have engagement and that kind of thing, but ultimately, you know, it's one person that puts that together or a team of people and presents it, and then so many people live it, like, you know.
It's, it's a little bit about human experience and our, in our age, isn't it? Live our lives, and who decides all of that stuff?
So bureaucratic as well, you know, like so bureaucratic, and that's an interesting part of my job. I wouldn't say I dislike it, but it's eye-opening when you.
So looking back, I guess you're feeling a great sense of freedom now with what how you live and what you do. It's quite a contrast.
Well, so I still do kind of some planning, some work as well. But yeah, like. This, I suppose, has gone from being a hobby to, I don't know, I've probably put it in a different space in my head. I always just thought this was, you know, a hobby, something I do for fun, which it is, but I feel like it's become more serious than that now, and it's actually, yeah, I feel like it's got a new sense of importance.
So you're developing a kind of perspective on your practice that's been changing, or...?
Is interesting, like there's definitely something I'm trying to say, or I'm trying to provoke people to think. I think of some of my work and I actually think, oh, that's a cool thing to be doing, and I want to keep going with that. And now that, I think, brings it over a line from just doing something because I enjoy it as well, and moulding them two things together.
Yeah. I mean, in a way, I think Grayson Perry sort of talks about some art practice that has become more like craft, and then so you learn some skills, but then if you really want to take it further, you're developing your own language. And I always think about art as being a language to help us think about things. It's not, it's stuff that you can't put into words always easily, but it is a language in a way. And I'm interested to see how it's all going to emerge, but we'll, I was wondering about asking you a little bit about some of the techniques that you started with and how you've developed an interest in that, because what you're showing here is, from a technical point of view, something that's been a little journey over a few years at least, I think.
Yeah.
But do you want to have any insights on that process?
Talking a little bit about this before, but it's largely, you know, monoprinting and printing, you know, block printing inks and etching and making marks, and they're quite premeditated. I've got an idea of what I want to do and what I'm trying to present when I'm doing that. Whether it be you know, a flurry of women kind of streaming down and I'm marking each individual one out and I know that that's going to be the basis for that piece, or it's, you know, kind of larger breastfeeding child, like that's the basis. But then quite often I'll press them, I'll do a few different pressings, I like to have some room to play around, and then I'll leave that. And often I wait until it feels quite organic to come back to their pieces and work on them more. And it's almost like I never know what the next bit's going to be. Like I'm quite decisive of the first bit. I know what I wanted to print, but then I'm not sure how I'm going to almost decorate that print, if that makes sense.
Well, that then becomes the reason to do it, doesn't it? Because it's the journey.
Yeah. And I suppose like my thinking can get a bit deeper when I'm going into that bit. Like, what am I trying to say here? What am I trying to do? And that's when I kind of throw the detail on top. Lots of it's quite mixed media, so watercolours, acrylics.
I see a bit of collage.
Yeah.
Done.
Yeah. So the collage, quite interesting, and I suppose as I've kind of been doing all of this work, rummaging through op shops, I enjoy that, I enjoy antiques, or
found images.
Yeah, and just looking at these old children books, like from the 50s, 60s, 70s, and reading them and finding it really interesting how women, or, you know, what's being marketed to women at that age, at that time, and lots of it's pretty sexist, you know, some pretty racist, sexist content in there, and just being amazed by that, not in a great way, but astounded, you know, like, I can't believe this is what we were giving to young girls at that time. And some of it's kind of, oh, we're going to give young women freedom or encourage them, but only within these confines, you know, like in this box. And I suppose me looking at them and taking their images and trying to, I suppose a few of them pictures, I think there's a bit of irony in there. And that's what I'm kind of playing on. But yeah.
Interesting. And I think it comes from, you know, in our daily life. I mean, where you grew up, you've got a bit of, you know, a 1,000-year-old history, and you've got some 19th century history, and all this imagery and everything, it's all part of your life in the 80s and 1980s and 1990s. So we live in a world full of this mixed up, it's like, it's not really linear history, is it? It's really quite a mishmash of all sorts of things that we have to try and make sense of in terms of representation.
Yeah, and I suppose having an appreciation for all of that as well, you know, and like you've just alluded to, maybe, where I'm from, you know.
You know, stained glass windows in those churches would have a particular kind of woman type, stereotypes, I guess. All of that stuff, so it's interesting. And I was wondering, because what came up in the little notes that I looked at when I was discovering your work for the first time, you were talking about that whole experience of motherhood and family life and how that really has become quite a strong consideration as you are making your work.
Yeah, I think that was probably the ignition to get back into art, and I don't know if that time I thought about the content too much, but definitely I wanted some kind of space for myself, and that became my space and what I was doing, and taking my head and using it in a different way, you know, like a nice way to exercise my brain that wasn't just being a mum, and to do something different over here, and that's really cool. But so I think that spurred me on to pick up some materials and start doing stuff. But then definitely I think the content's also largely reflective of that, on a few different levels. I think on one level, like my personal changes to my body, changes to other women's body through that process of childbirth and being pregnant and realizing just how powerful women are and that we do this amazing thing. And the contrast then, I suppose, to how women are actually regarded and treated in society, and that's not as equals. And especially in the art world as well, you know, historically women have been underrepresented and, had a harder ride for sure. And I feel like that comes through in some of my work as well. I think sometimes a little bit of anger in there. A little bit of frustration as well.
And maybe rewriting or forging a new conception of how you think things should be or what they ought to be?
Yeah, I think kind of trying to demonstrate the protest, so, you know, to kind of look like, you know, the same now, please, like, this is, and trying to provoke some thought around that. And I suppose that's what I think I'm trying to do, not necessarily tell a story, but get people to look at my work and think, oh, like, why is that there? What does it mean? What could it mean? Lots of female body parts, you know, lots of breasts, like vaginas. I think areas of female body that have sexualised.
Well, by a certain not by women all the time, but
And then having children, you know, then parts of your body take on a new role as well, and it just made me think a lot about that. And I also found it really interesting with some of my work, just different audiences. And I noticed a few times that men that I knew as well, if they looked at it, they often just turned that aspect of my work into a bit of a joke or, you know, comical. And I almost felt like it was their discomfort with looking at that. And I thought that was a really interesting reaction. And I wanted to explore that more and push it more. And it's just spurred me on to, like, go further down that path. You know, why is that, that discomfort of me, you know, presenting these things in this way? I don't know. But I thought it was interesting. And
I think maybe it's a new conversation or something that men might not be used to thinking about.
Yeah.
I thought it was really interesting overhearing you talking to one of the people at the opening last night, a woman, and clearly as you were talking about your work, I could see where she was in her own life starting to resonate a little bit, and I think she became interested in buying some of your work because what there was something in your work which validated where she was in her life. And I mean, I'm not saying that it was therapy or she was an emotional wreck or anything. You know, I'm just saying it resonated with her, with her life experience, and somehow the visual nature of seeing the, some of those ideas or, you know, aspects of your experience seemed to just be something that she thought might be quite desirable to have in her life. So I thought that was an interesting, just eavesdropping in on that conversation, but it was interesting to me.
And that's really nice as well, to kind of hear that and to have them conversations with people. And I feel like there's a bit of two-way learning as well, because it's interesting hearing what other people are perceiving. And sometimes I'm quite surprised, you know, that people say back to me. And I don't know if it's your subconscious that does some of the work for you and you don't realise, but yeah, people definitely take different things from.
So I guess from my point of view, somebody who was being a historian and somebody who reviews exhibitions and writes about art, I've kind of like been thinking about the sort of feminist framework and how all that sort of fits together. That's why I was asking you about when you were born and how you, some of those sorts of ideas. But are you consciously aware of some of the other women's art around you, or is it for you, is it very much more a personal and an internal journey, or is it a bit of both?
I think a bit of both, like definitely inspired by different female artists like Judy Chicago, Jenny Saville. Like, I find her art really interesting as well, because it's quite provoking in that, you know, she's not presenting women as these beautiful, dainty things all the time. Like, some of it's quite confronting and graphic, and I think I read somewhere, you know, like, people might not actually want to put this on their walls, but, you know, it's not necessarily pretty, or, you know, that I really enjoy that, and I feel like that's the real raw thought-provoking. Some of the colour palette I use as well, like the greens and the purples, that's a bit of a nod to the women's liberation movement. So I know a large part of their work was focused around art and getting equality. Back in the day, 1800s,
1900s,
felt really inspired by.
Tell me a bit about the colour connection, greens and the purples.
So they used to use that in their kind of emblems and their logos and their posters. So green, white, purple, and sometimes gold. Real bold, kind of striking posters, and it might link in as well to the older images from the vintage storybooks and things like that. But making these posters that were sometimes got quite a negative reception, I think, from women and from men, and you know, from and plastering them around, you know, fighting that battle, trying to,
yeah.
and achieving things as well by doing that. So.
Yeah, there's a certain, if you've got a social message, being controversial is a good way of, you know, getting up, stepping up, I guess, isn't it? It's about putting your head above the parapet to some degree.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, you know, for that time as well, you know, back in that day, what they were doing was actually quite controversial. They were like an older days guerrilla girls or something like that. But so taking some of that colour palette sometimes, and I think you can see in these two pieces over here, it's a bit of a nod.
I think they're so beautiful, and the it's almost the way you've put those colours together is quite special, I think, and it worked extremely well. I think they're some of the strongest works, and they're really super. And I'm, you know, that's coming from me, who likes black and white more than anything, but grey, you know, on a good day. But no, they work really well. I think it's something worth exploring too, you know. But I'm really interested in the history of pigments and colours and how all that works. It has worked over time for people, but it's really interesting to hear you talk about that.
Yeah.
Are there any other contemporary women artists that you feel particularly interested in?
On the spot thinking, hey.
Sorry.
No, you're all good. I really like Fiona Rye, who's not so much kind of focused directly on female form, but kind of interesting images that you have to look at, I think, and depict to take what you want from them, or, you know.
They're quite provocative,
yeah,
what would you say?
Yeah, they are. And I feel like very beautiful,
mm-hmm.
and you know, sometimes I love that aesthetic as well. Like, it's not, I don't think her images are always easily depicted, like it's not, you know, obvious what's going on here, but I love that. And beautiful colour palettes, and someone I studied actually when I was doing my A-level arts, and really has stayed with me, and really interested.
So what's her name again?
Fiona Rye.
Fiona Rye.
Yeah.
And she's a British.
I'm not sure if she's British. I went to
look her up.
Yeah, I went to the Tate in London when we were back in the UK recently, and she had works up on the wall in there. And that was really special. I didn't know they were going to be there, so I was real excited when I was wandering around and I saw some of her work around. And Marilyn Minter, do you know? So she's really interesting artist who focuses on female autonomy and body parts, lots of lips, photography and painting, I believe, real close-up images. And I think I read somewhere that kind of the starting of that was her mother was quite a glamorous woman or used to wear lots of makeup, and that was a focus of hers from her childhood memory, and kind of zooming in and, a real focus on female. And I don't know how to describe her art.
I always think one of the nice things about talking with artists is, you know, because you never know everything, so it's when you start with one approach and then someone recommends, have a look at this, have a look at that, have you seen these? It's a really nice part of the whole discovery and life that I can bring to our daily worldview.
And I feel like that's kind of, I'm going deeper into my learning around that, which is new territory, but interesting.
So one of the things I was thinking about was that there's kind of like, there's a sort of a feminist theory framework that we could, you know, slot this into or give a context. And but more recently I've been looking at the whole idea of embodiment. And I'm not sure if you've come across the whole idea of embodiment, creativity, but it was something that I was thinking about when I was reading what you were saying. It's the idea that the body itself, our bodies and our own, the sensation of our bodies, and has been an interesting starting place for a lot of creativity as well. And I thought that idea sort of tied in with your references to motherhood and childbirth and all of that, you know, that sort of very physical response to the world and sensation, how we think about it.
Yeah, definitely. And I feel like some of the changes that you go through after, you know, the process of having children or just even aging, and especially women, you know, lots of it isn't embraced traditionally that naturally. It's not, I mean, people fight it. We fight to look different.
We pretend it's not happening.
Yeah.
Definitely, it's never going to come to us. Yeah.
But I think as well, there's a bit of me that wants to, like, normalise some of that, you know, kind of women's bodies after birth, kind of the muffin tops, your body's stretched, your skin's been stretched, it's not the same as it was, and we don't need to wear control pants to pull that back in, or, you know, we shouldn't feel like we have to, and there should be a proudness in, you know, these battle scars, if you want to call them battle scars. But, and I don't know, I feel like there is, you know, socially there's a movement where things have become like I don't want to word this in a way that I won't like later, but yeah, like there's a movement towards people feeling more comfortable with not trying to, you know, bring themselves back from these changes that have happened. But yeah, I think they need to be celebrated, and I actually think lots of it's quite beautiful, and it's not something we should be trying to reverse or be, you know, and plastering some images of that up there and getting people thinking about it.
It's so culturally embedded too. I was talking with a friend, she came back from Italy with a whole lot of photos, and I was like, yeah, well, because, you know, working in art galleries and museums, I work a lot with women, you know, and I was saying to my friend, well, these Italian women, that's the normal way a woman's body is at the age of 50, and they have no self-consciousness about it. They just live it normally. You just end up with the shape of a normal woman, and yes, sometimes there's a little bit more than we would, you know, the American ideal might necessarily be showing in popular media, but in a lot of cultures, the acceptance of the feminine body is, you know, it's very different to what we might pick up from the media images.
So interesting. And one of my friends, good friends who I did art with at school actually, she actually had breast cancer while she was pregnant, and I feel like that has found its way into some of my work, and she had a hysterectomy. And you know, I also think there's something there where women, you know, she got her breasts removed to take something awful away, but there's also a feeling that you need to put them back afterwards and be reconstructed for some people, and that's for all different reasons, but it's interesting.
And everyone has their own reasons. And
yeah, for sure.
Feelings about it. Yeah, wow.
Yeah. But it's interesting. And I was going to say something. But yeah. And I also feel there's a bit of an underappreciation, you know, because I feel kind of the way that women present themselves is hopefully a form of expression, you know, like it's not necessarily a negative thing. If people want to wear makeup or people want to wear high heels, I think it's all expression, and that's a great thing, and express yourself however you want to be. But then I do think there's a lot of work that goes into that expression for some people, and for some people maybe it's not a choice, it's more like, you know, kind of
a bit of an obsession or neurosis.
Well, this is what I have to do to present myself to society, you know, this is what's acceptable and this is how I have to look.
Yeah, well, certainly some of my aunts would say their husbands have never seen them without makeup.
Yeah.
And they get up and make themselves up early in the morning and then they take it all off.
That's crazy.
Late at night.
Yeah.
So, But that was a generation too. So.
I think things like that get passed down as well, you know, like, and definitely, like you just alluded to, different cultures, you know, do things differently, and it's interesting.
One of the critiques of feminist theory is that some aspects of feminism haven't really embraced the biology of being, well, you know, a lot of it has been about equal political rights and equal property rights, and then equality in the workplace with men, and a lot of that, some people might say, has come at the cost of ignoring the biological reality for women. But I wondered, so I was thinking about the role of biology and, you know, what you were sort of saying in your work about some of those aspects too.
I suppose I've thought about this quite a bit in my own head as well, and I was actually talking to my partner about it last night, and it's crazy that men physically, you know, are biologically often a lot stronger than women, and physically they have dominance,
yeah.
And, you know, unfortunately that's why women are victims a lot of the time as well, because of that biological, but then I suppose with that process of pregnancy and childbirth, and women actually going so close to the edge of death.
Yeah, it's life and death. Yeah.
So close to the edge, and how strong women are to do that, and mentally all of the stuff that they deal with on top of that, and the resilience. And to some of that critique, I would kind of use that as an argument, like, in that, yes, men have physical dominance and strength in this realm, but like, there's also something over here that women have that I just don't even think could be fathomed by a man, because it's not experienced in that strength.
Men have a fragility, and it doesn't come out in a lot of feminist theory, and we don't talk about it in politics, but men have a fragility, and you also have to say, how did men get that strength? Who was feeding that boy?
Yeah.
You know, who was keeping that baby alive? And so the way that the physical strength has developed has usually been, and will can only happen, because of the dedication and strength of the mother to feed the child and protect the child when it's vulnerable. And then these boys grow up to be these strong physical things. But they're not. They still have a vulnerability. And mothers know, every mother knows that. Every wife knows that. You know, but we don't talk about it so much.
Definitely. And perhaps we're starting to talk about it more, or we're starting to acknowledge it more.
Well, it frees men up too to have those conversations.
Yeah, which is, you know, awesome thing. Everyone should feel equal in that sense too.
But the biological reality is interesting, because art historians have a problem now that they've never had before. I guess it's only in the recent decade or so that people have even talked about it a little bit, which is how to write about the careers of women who have these long lives, because we're now, art historians are needing to write about women who maybe were productive for 70, maybe more years, and how to talk about their creativity, which has been relevant or maybe less relevant to women who've been making art for three generations, you know, and how to really get a perspective on their careers, because biologically these women because they're women and living longer, they're posing a whole interesting challenge to the art world, simply by being present, by hanging on to their vision and their creative energy, and how they've developed over that time. So but it's a biological fact that women have been living for a long time and having very productive artistic careers, whereas often art historians are used to writing about the avant-garde, and that's often been about men, and how long have they been relevant for, maybe 20 or 30 years at their peak.
Yeah.
So it's quite the biology of women artists and how they think about that is a new challenge in some ways.
Yeah, sure, and yeah, interesting. Like, I've never thought too much about that before. That definitely, historically, looking back as well, it must be quite hard to write about a lot of
Well, I mean, I was interested to think, you know, in preparation for chatting to you today, thinking about, you know, the right, all, you know, my last two reviews for Art New Zealand have been about women artists. The book that I commissioned was about, you know, but there are a lot of gaps to fill, and it takes a special sort of determination to try and tackle some of those problems. But it seems crazy that we're talking about some of these things in the beginning of our century, when we've almost had 100 years of reflecting on some of these problems too.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? Problem that we've got today.
But I love seeing some of the imagery and this one here, which has this sort of cascade of hieroglyphs or something a little symbolic, women that are all just sort of in their rows and coming down through the generations. I'm not sure how that's how I sort of saw it, but it reminded me of a lot of cave art and prehistoric art, where some of the earliest things that humans made were fertility images, or we interpret them as fertility images of women. And then I was thinking, because my first degree was in Byzantine and medieval art, and our professor would say, well, how do you know these images were made of men? I mean, these frescoes or mosaics, that they're actually in nunneries. There were no men, men were never allowed in them. So her idea was that these were always images made by women in women's spaces, and even some of the early, what we wouldn't say, of fertility images, how do we know they were made by men? Maybe they were made by women, for other women. So, you know, art history's still got a lot of question marks about it, but I think it's quite wrong to assume that a lot of the early images of women were not made by women themselves.
Yeah.
But that your work brought up all of those thoughts for me.
Yeah, it's so interesting, hey? And even the women, even when they're the subject matter, you know, going on, and when we do know things for sure, lots of the time it's men's drawing of women, or paintings, it's, you know, male focus of women. And that's not to say, again, that lots of women weren't painting women, but they're not the ones that kind of made it through to popular culture at the time.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's quite interesting.
Mm. And I think for me it also comes down to the trajectory of the lives of women artists. So your background and then your professional life and then your experience as a mother and then having more time and creating a space for your own artwork, that's not an unusual pattern for women artists. And I still think some of that needs to be still taken, like it's not how a male artist or a traditional route might be, but it's still a journey that I'm prepared to take seriously. And even working in sort of small community galleries and exhibiting, you know, all of that, that's still a very authentic and valuable area of consideration for me, and one that can still be taken seriously and be built on to create a space and a dialogue which is very valid and interesting. An artistic and cultural perspective.
And it is interesting. Like, I don't feel like I do have more time. I feel like I've got less time than I've ever had in my life. But I feel.
But
like,
you're making time.
Yeah, and I think I use it better, you know? Like, I'm just a little more cutthroat with what I need to do and what I want to do. And actually knowing what I want to do, you know, for my own mental well-being as well. And using my time better than I ever have.
Because I mean, the thing about little kids is that they're never wrong. So and so everything they need, their demands are sort of very intense, aren't they?
Yeah.
So that invites a sort of a response.
Yeah, from this. And I think some of that, like my lifestyle, is reflected in the work. Like I think it is like often built up in layers because I don't have large chunks of time just to sit and focus all at once. So it is quite progressive. just try and embrace them and make it beautiful, because that's what I feel is kind of
what's
happening.
What's beautiful to you? How would you explore that?
What is beautiful to me? I suppose it's that feeling it provokes, hey, like if it's happiness and something that, because I want to say, you know, something that's aesthetically pleasing, but that's different for everyone. And
I was thinking about the word fresh, you know, I sort of feel there's quite a lot of freshness and airiness,
yeah.
And, you know, there's,
okay.
There's not sort of a lot of overworking and over glossing and, you know.
Yeah.
It's quite an immediacy, which is, has its beauty, I think.
Yeah.
But what do you think?
I quite enjoy the detail of some of the work. So there's obviously the, I think the rawness is where it starts, you know, the printing and kind of putting a base down. Then I think building on that with the detail is where a lot of it becomes more beautiful to me.
Looking at the colour work.
Yeah. And it is interesting because I'm not, choosing a colour palette or adding detail to specific things in, a, in an image, I think. Yeah.
It's great. I really appreciate having your insights, and we've been talking for a while now.
Yeah.
Just by way of wrapping things up, I guess. I was wondering if you saw your work that we've got in this exhibition, do you see it as kind of summative and sort of whether you've arrived at a point where this is sort of a conclusion of one chapter and now you're going to move on to something else, or do you see it, this work as having further to evolve? Do you get what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
I'm sort of saying what's next. You know,
I feel like kind of the base of this, like the subject matter, all the feelings that it's provoked to kind of get me into creating, I think that's going to stay, and I think that's going to be the foundations for what I keep doing.
Mm.
But I think it will evolve in that, you know, my life's changing again, and my body's changing, and, you know, how do I embrace that now? I think lots of this part of the journey has finished because it was a point in time. But then I think, yeah, the core of some of this, you know, is still going to be a massive focus for me. I think it's still ongoing, you know, and I feel passionate about it and I want to keep going with it. But then, I can see changes coming. But definitely.
So maybe my final question should be something like, do you have any insights into how making this work changes your, or is part of your evolving understanding of who you are as a person? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so. Do I have any insight into it?
So I mean, sort of, so seeing all this stuff, bringing things to the surface in your consciousness, how does that, or does that help you or give you insights into your own growth or changing mindset about yourself?
Yeah, it definitely does, in that I think keep going, and it's making me feel stronger and confident, you know, keep going with what you're trying to express, and it's interesting watching people respond to that. Like, that's one of the things I enjoy the most, like people's responses and exploring their responses and exploring what I like about them and not. It's making me sit back and question a lot of what I'm doing, and I think more targeting on what it is exactly that I am trying to express with certain pieces. But definitely, I think, also learning, like I just want to learn more, like new techniques, new ways of doing things. So from a skills growth perspective as well, you know, to keep exploring and doing different things, different materials. Yeah. Is that the kind of answer?
Yeah, no, that's good. Yeah. I guess I'm looking forward to the next exhibition now.
Thank you. Yeah.
Oh, well, thanks for the chat.
Yeah,
and,
thank you so much, Dave.
I know, well, there's always a balance as to how much we prepare and how much do we just let the conversation flow, but I think hopefully we've got the balance right.